Welcome to another edition of the Resilient Living Podcast, a show dedicated to improving quality of life for both people and planet through liberation and independence, moving from surviving to thriving and living life on your own terms.
All right, I'm excited about this topic today, and it's about emergency preparedness, but all about energy. I think there's so much to talk about that we need to kind of segregate it, like keep little parts of it and just kind of explore each individual. And I'm very, very, very excited to do this one today. Please pardon the background noise. And for those of you watching this on the YouTube, the sun's barely coming out. It's a beautiful sunrise this morning, but it's a little dark and it's kind of hiding the wrinkles in my face. Well, let's get in it today. So yes, emergency preparedness, all about energy. Now, I know some of you guys are going to say I'm missing a bunch of stuff, but I can't really afford to do an entire show about all of them, but we're going to try to skim over as many as possible. And for those of you watching this show about this energy, if you like this show in your ears on the podcast, I can only afford to do about 30 minutes. So if we end up going overboard, go check out the channel on YouTube, and you can actually watch the extended version. We've got a lot of good stuff for you today. All right, my first one is a generator. And why would you need a generator? Because if you're reliant on the energy grid and a power outage of anywhere in the United States, pretty much. I mean, I'm in Sunnyside, California, San Diego in particular, and we just had an earthquake yesterday. I think it was a 4.3 or something in the Anza Borrego in the desert area, and shook a bunch of stuff up. We don't know whether we have a big one, a little one, at any time. Something could happen. The power lines could go down. And you think about how long you'd be without energy. Now, we have different parts of the world, too, where sunrise is completely captivating, guys. We have places in the world where, even like Texas, where it got this huge deep freeze thing that happened, and it actually took down lines and stuff. I mean, people have hurricanes, we have tornadoes, we have all kinds of different things that could happen. And why is it so significant to get a generator? It's because if you are prepared, doing like food preparations, and you've got a freezer full of meat and frozen vegetables and, you know, a lot of things like that, you're going to need to have energy. Otherwise, all of your stuff is pretty much gone. It's all going to thaw out and you're pretty much screwed. So we need a generator for many, many things. Maybe some people for warmth, you know, and we've got a whole bunch of stuff we're going to talk about that today. But there are generators I think a lot of people aren't aware of that function off of both propane and gas. So that's a pretty cool thing where you can... In my book, you see, guys, gasoline or diesel will spoil after a while, whereas propane will last in a tank for many, many, many years. I don't even know if it even ever goes bad. Somebody who knows about that, maybe throw a comment in here. But you can store some tanks off to the side and run those for your energy if needed. I've got like these 35-gallon ones. They're pretty heavy. They're probably about 250 pounds each when they're full. But you get something like that, get about four or five of those, and not only could you cook, you can produce electricity as well. And that way you don't lose everything. So yeah, when you have a generator, we have to start thinking about our fuels. And energy, we want to think about everything in here as energy. I think it was Tesla said that, think of life as what, frequency, energy, and I can't remember, light, I think it was. Then light, I believe that's what the three were. But when we think about energy, sometimes we just think about fuels and stuff like that, right? Producing electricity. But there's a lot of different things that actually hold energy that I think you guys aren't aware of. And one of them is candles. And one of the most genius things I've seen my grandfather do is he made a breakfast, and it was very cold. My grandfather grew up in the Great Depression era. And what he did is he had these stainless steel plates that he made breakfast for everybody early in the morning, and he lit candles. He put them up on these little stainless steel racks. And they were elevated maybe about, you know, 6 inches off the table. And underneath them, he put a candle, and that kept everything warm. Well, for those of you guys who don't know, you can actually use a series of clay pots where you light up maybe three or four candles in a small room, put a clay pot over it, and then extend another larger clay pot over that. And there's some variations. I don't have time to go into detail today. But you can literally, off candles, you can produce your own heat. And then if we start looking about stacking functions, as we like to say, borrowing one of the permaculture sayings out there, it's producing light, right? We're doing two things at once. If you lit a bunch of candles in your home, and they have these ones, guys, that are, they're quite expensive. I've been looking to invest in them. For some reason or another, I have not. But they're very small. I think they're only about 3 inches tall, and they're about maybe, I don't know, about 2 inches in diameter. And these things are like 8-hour candles. They got a specific wax that they're made out of, and probably a specific wick. And these little candles will last a long time. It's more, I'd say, affordable. You get a better price if you buy in bulk, like say about 500 or 1,000 of them. And you got a lot of hours that don't need batteries, don't need anything. You can cook with these things. If you put enough of them under a frying pan, you can produce light, you can produce heat. So I want to get you guys in that mode of thinking, well, what are the ways of energy? What are some of the different things that we can do? So we look at firewood. Firewood is actually a hidden fuel. We look at that, most people just overlook it and say, well, you know, it's a little fire or something. But no, that is actually a stored fuel. And we have stuff all around us. I want to get into rocket mass stoves too, where you can literally cook and heat your home off basically junk mail or twigs, right? And it's complete, it doesn't even emit that much smoke at all, if any. So we got to think of energy in many, many ways, and firewood is one of the best ones. I think if you can get your hands on oak, madrone wood, eucalyptus, things like that, and keep them in rotation, I believe, like for me, eucalyptus is going to last probably anywhere from 2 to 3, maybe 4, even 5 years before it starts to decompose. And it's a very dense, heavy wood for those of you guys just starting out with the prepping and survival kind of stuff. You know, a lot. You notice how you'll get a piece of pine and you'll burn it, and it just, and feel the weight of it. It's not very dense. It just burns right up. Whereas that madrone or the oak or the eucalyptus, that stuff's going to take a long time to burn. It throws off a lot more heat. Next one too is surprising. Greases and animal fats. If you've got bacon grease, guys ever dump some bacon grease accidentally over the stove on a gas lid, or you've been camping or something, you drizzle a little bit in there and watch it just light up, ignite on fire. This is also a fuel. It also could be a food. So we started talking about stacking functions. Now we take something as animal fats or like bacon grease, Crisco. You can use Crisco to light stuff on fire as well, firewood. Oh, so we start looking at these things, and literally, again, we don't have that much time to go in full detail, but you can literally get yourself a wick and you can light yourself up a little can full, like a tin can with Crisco or animal fats or bacon grease, and you can literally create yourself a candle to do light, to cook with, to heat something, and in most cases of the stuff, you could actually eat it as well. So we start broadening the energy resources that we have. Flint is another energy source I look at. Maybe some people debate me and say no, but if you had yourself some tinder, you were in the woods, maybe the power went out in your home or something, your Bic lighter or your matches got wet, stuff wouldn't work. Flint, to me, is considered an energy. Flint is, for those of you who don't know, is actually this resource, this element that you get. It looks like maybe a bar of soap or something, or I don't know, like a battery. It comes in many different shapes and stuff. And you just basically flip a knife upside down, scratch the top of it really hard with some pressure, and a bunch of sparks come off of it. And that's how you're able to ignite, you know, tinder to get stuff lit. So, and that's a resource that never goes bad. It's a lighter you'll have for many, many, many years. But if you're a full-blown survivalist out in the woods all the time, I think you definitely would go through a couple. But for the average Joe, they'll probably have it their whole entire lifetime. You know, it's just something good to have. And it's maybe a few, like $2-3, right? And you could sit that aside knowing that you have a forever lighter that you can ignite something. I mean, if you needed to ignite even a gas fireplace or something, or you can ignite it. These things are really awesome. So let's get in some energy ones of where people look at the sun. You're aware of solar panels, I'm sure. Yes, not photosynthesis, but that is a good one too. The plants utilize photosynthesis as energy to create sugar and to grow. But a Fresnel lens is basically harnessing the sun where into a focal point. I don't know if there's anybody still imaginative out there and had the chance to actually be a real kid, a human being with freedom, and be able to run around and do stupid stuff like burning ants with a magnifying glass, you know, or starting little fires or something, put it on your hand and burn yourself. Well, Fresnel lenses are a very large makeup of this. They're made out of glass, I believe. Maybe there's some other stuff, but I'm not aware of it. But it's basically just a huge, giant magnifying glass. And what you can do is you can cook with these things. You can burn, you can do artwork. There's all kinds of things. You can heat water. And basically what it does is just like a magnifying glass. It focals the prisms of light to a sharp point. So whatever you aim it at, it's going to heat stuff up. So we can imagine if you were able to place this down on, say, like a large sheet of steel or something. And as that heats up, you put your pot of water on the other end, not directly into the Fresnel lens prism, and that's going to heat up your water for nothing. Definitely some uses on these things. I mean, I think you can even create probably a locomotive like steam engine off one of these things. The possibilities are endless. The next one I have is solar cookers, and this is also utilizing the sun. It's basically a little box, or I've seen people make them themselves out of rubber tires and stuff like that, which I highly do not recommend for toxicity reasons. It's just ridiculous cooking food in a rubber tire, and a tire that goes to the landfill, and they actually scrape the dirt because the dirt is so toxic at a landfill. Yeah, it's very not good for you, I'd like to say. But I do have my problems with solar cookers too. They're usually made out of plastic. And what it is, it's got a solar reflective panel around the whole perimeter of it, or maybe half of it, or three quarters, depending on which model you're looking at. And what it does is it focals that sun, that all that heat, that light, into the through the glass inside this box where you'll have, say, your soup. And you'll have a like plexiglass or a glass lid that goes over it. And as that light goes in there and heats up the internal temperatures, you can literally bake bread. You can heat up soups, you can cook hamburgers, whole chicken. I've seen people doing all kinds of things, even in the snow, guys. As long as there's a clear day and you've got that sun shining, that thing will heat up. So you can imagine this thing like a greenhouse. For any of you who have experience, if you built a little, I don't know, a 4x4 foot greenhouse and you put it in the sun, that thing will instantly, as the sun rises, it'll be like 100 something plus degrees. If you take yourself a large greenhouse and you put it in the sun, it's going to get up to some high temperatures. And I mean completely enclosed, guys, like wrapped like a Ziploc bag. You're going to find that it's going to take a lot longer for the large greenhouse, say a 20 by 50 foot, you know, to get to the temperatures as a small one. So it's harnessing a lot of the solar energy relatively quickly. And when we think about a solar cooker, it's a very small box, maybe about a 1x1 foot cube, you know, or maybe a little bit larger. You concentrate that light in there with a Fresnel lens kind of action or a reflectiveness of a solar reflector. It's going to heat up really fast enough to actually cook stuff. All right, the next one is we were talking about firewood and stuff like that. And this is a Dakota fire hole. And basically the way I can explain this to you guys, it's like digging a U-shaped hole, like a gopher hole with your hand or a stick or something inside the dirt. And it would be best if you did this where you had a higher point at one end, right? So maybe a little incline of land where you would dig a hole, make your U come up to the higher end. This is going to cause suction. And what this is going to do is, say in survival out in the woods, is you would line the upper hole with rocks around the top. Leave the breathing hole on the top. And then what you're going to do is you're going to set your water, your whatever, maybe your purifying water or making soup or cooking a squirrel or something, I don't know. But what you're going to do is you're going to light a fire at the bottom end. And what's going to happen, you may need to start this thing where you blow a little bit through the hole. It's going to cause this vacuum. And hence, that's what a rocket mass stove, that's what it does. Is as the heat rises, it causes suction. And what's going to happen is it's sucking air from where the entry of the fire at the lower end is. And it's blowing air up. And it's sucking air in. Fire needs oxygen. So what happens is it turns into like a torch. And you can do this just simply in the dirt. You don't really even need a rocket mass stove. So really, in the survival situation, in the nitty-gritty, you can do this pretty much anywhere in the world. I believe you could even do it with sand if you get the sand to not collapse. Well, that'd probably be a little bit more difficult. I'd say like a clay, loamy sand, sandy soil area. You could probably do a formation with rocks and stuff and actually seal it with some sand. And I imagine that you can actually make one that way as well. So yeah, so it's a rocket mass stove is, we're moving forward here. Rocket mass stove is basically the same principle. Now there's many, many variations. Rocket mass stoves also can be used to do dehydration of food. It can be used to make a hot tub to heat water for like a little jacuzzi. It can be used to cook, bake. It can be used to heat your home. And literally, guys, you can just stuff twigs in there. And because of the centrifugal force, I guess you'd call it, of the vacuum, it literally throws this torch and you can cook stuff on just a few twigs. You don't need very large logs at all. So I heard of people even actually heating their home with just junk mail for a year. And I think it was somewhere really cold, like Wyoming. So that gives you guys a general idea of how powerful and how these things can be implemented in your lives. They could be done on large or even very micro scale. So one of the things I thought about getting for myself for my preparedness survival kit is a rocket mass stove. I don't have the time to make my own, and I don't have a welder, but these things are literally like 13 inches tall, and they're very compact. Something you can throw in your vehicle, take camping, or an emergency situation, go get yourself some twigs and, you know, heat your home, or cook some food, many, many different variations. I thought it was just a good thing to have, like a Swiss Army knife, you know, or preparedness of having extra fuels and stuff like that. Have yourself a rocket mass stove just sitting there, but utilizing it. I would love to go camping and just have me a bunch of little twigs instead of using my propane stove to cook some hot chocolate or something like that. Use the rocket mass stove. Energy, thermal cookers. So these are things, again, people, that you're probably not thinking of. Most of you guys probably never even heard of a thermal cooker. Basically, in a nutshell, what a thermal cooker is it's this very large thermosy kind of thing. So it's a large thermos, it's insulated, and it's got an airtight lid. And basically what you do is you got yourself a stainless steel cooking container, a vessel, and you're gonna cook your food. You're gonna heat up, I've done lamb stew. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna take your lamb and you're gonna stick it on the bottom and you're gonna sear it over a fire or the stove or something like that. Get it all nice so it's not gonna fall apart. You're gonna fill this thing up full of the fluids and everything, you know, the juices, whatever you want, your potatoes, carrots, whatever you're putting in there. And you're gonna let this thing boil for about 10 minutes on a full bone boil. And normally to make stew and make things tender, you'd have to cook this thing for a long time on low simmer. What the thermal cookware does is literally has a pot that fits inside of a pot too. So let's just say you're making stew, you let it boil for 10 minutes, close the lid, stick it inside the thermos, close the lid. Maybe let's say we wanted some rice. Throw yourself some rice inside the little container that seats on top. They just basically sandwich together. And boil some water, get it nice and hot. Again, get it to a rolling boil for maybe about, I would say, 5 minutes. Have your rice and everything already in there. Put the lid on top of that rice one, stick that container within the container of the lamb stew, close the whole thermal lid, wait for about 6, 7, 8 hours, open it up, and you got a full-blown cooked meal that sits there cooking all day, slow cooking, with no energy whatsoever, just the initial bump. Now, we imagine if we took a rocket mass stove and we heated these things up individually, and then we stuck them in the, we put these things in the thermal cookware. We literally just produced energy for free. If we use the Fresnel lens, all kinds of, if we use the thermal cooker, or I'm sorry, the solar cooker. So many, many variations. And a thermos as well. That's an energy-saving a device that you have. Making hot cocoa for your children, right? making your own lunches. A lot of you guys probably wouldn't want to do what I'm doing for my extreme money-saving techniques where you're eating cold smoothies for lunch, you know, at work. Maybe you want something hot. Very genius. I seen some of the Mexican guys I had working for me years ago. Their wife or them, I don't know who, they would probably microwave or make a giant breakfast burrito. And they would literally, they'd wrap it in foil and stuff it inside the thermos and close the lid. Now, I don't think that thing by noon, you know, or mid-morning is going to be like entirely like steaming hot, but it's definitely not going to be cold. It's probably going to be anywhere from super hot, super hot and cold to like this good medium heat, this comfortable, tasty heat. So thermoses, I think, definitely have a bunch of those around for yourself. And then solar power equipment, definitely, I think that's pretty popular. I don't think I need to explain too much on that other than I think that a lot of people should probably invest in DC equipment. So if a lot of you guys don't know, you can't just plug in a laptop to a solar system. You know, you got to have a solar panel which captures the sun, sends the energy down some wires into a converter, a charge controller, and converter. It's going to take that energy and it's going to put it into the batteries. And when the batteries are too full, you're going to have this charge controller stop the flow of energy so that the batteries don't explode and don't, you know, get overcharged, basically. It shuts everything off. So what you do then is you get yourself an inverter, and that plugs into your batteries. And what that does, it takes a lot of juice, too. is once you turn it on, it starts to work to convert the DC power that's stored in your batteries to AC power. So I know that might be confusing to some people, and guys already know this, so I'm just going to make it quick. You know, your whole home is AC power. It's already converted. So you just basically plug something in and go for it. Where that's not going to happen in a solar panel system without an inverter. So you want to get yourself a bunch of DC ran, excuse the background noise, geez. You want to get yourself some DC powered equipment, such as, let's see, what do I have? I have a truck jumper box that's in the backseat of my truck. I use that to jump start my truck. I can charge my cell phones up to like 30 times. It's got light that lasts for probably 24 hours. But you know what? Every time I jumpstart my truck, if I needed to, or jumpstart somebody else, I plug it into the cigarette lighter in my truck, or I could hook it up to my solar panel system in the back, and I can recharge that battery in there. And it's perpetual. It's free motion. I'm already driving anyways, but my solar that I have on my vehicle here is free energy as well. It's all I have to do is plug whatever I want into it. But having these solar-powered equipment is very, very, I think, important. I've got a flashlight in my backseat here that I use at work. Your cell phones and things like that, you can get these mini little inverters, inverters. I plug into your cigarette light, and you can keep your cell phone charged. Batteries, you can do all kinds of different things. Little fans I have for when it gets super hot. I used to take my old dog with me to work, and I'd lay her in the back of my truck. I had a mattress and everything for her. And I just put a little oscillating fan that was powered by DC power. So the reason why, to finish this up, why you're going to want to invest in the DC powered equipment, in contrast to AC, is that, remember what I said, the inverter takes a lot of energy. So what's going to happen is if you just had a house fan and you put an inverter on, depending on the size of your battery bank, you'd probably drain that thing and then you would be depleted of energy. So you'd only be able to use it for a while. Whereas a DC that runs straight off the batteries, where you can literally take the positive and negative terminals, right? And you can just clamp them onto a car battery. Wham, they start working. A lot less energy, a lot more efficient. All right, so next one is a truck battery bank. Now, I'm not too educated in this matter. When I was talking to you about how I can charge a cell phone or anything I want, basically, while I'm driving my car through my cigarette lighter. Well, that's because my alternator is constantly running. For those of you who don't know what an alternator is, when you start your car, it constantly runs. And what it does is it sends energy, just like a solar power system, just like a windmill, sends power to keep your batteries topped off. Now, the question I have is, can you hurt a alternator? And this is the thing, I don't know really, you know, if it would wear it out. But basically, if you're able to charge two batteries like I am in this noisy diesel pickup truck, why would you not be able to get, say, something like a toolbox in the back of your truck or your trunk of your car, run a wire, split the wire that goes from your alternator to your batteries, run that wire to, say, about 10 batteries in your trunk, maybe even 20 in the back of a toolbox, you know, and you can actually charge all of those batteries and have a huge power bank that literally stays topped off every time you start your car. And you think about how much power that would be, how many amp hours. We don't have time detail to go into that, but amp hours, basically, in short, it's each battery will have, say, I don't know, 100 amp hours. We'll make it simple. And when you use a fan, a DC powered fan, let's just say it uses up 10 amp hours. So that means that I can't even think about it. Basically, it's like a gas tank. You would know that maybe you had 10 hours before that. If my math, I'm trying to focus and drive here, but it lets you know basically how much gas you have inside that gas can, how much energy you have stored in that battery, all your appliances through knowing what the voltage and what the amp pool is on these things. You can understand, well, okay, that's how long I can run this piece of machinery. So if you had, you know, a giant battery bank, you can literally throw a fan on. You could probably even power a DC powered fridge for an entire day. And all you have to do is start your car. Now, I think I heard one of these on the Survival Podcast from Jack Spirko. I can't remember the guy's name that was on there, but they were talking about doing something similar like this and starting your car, having fuel stored up for emergency. And let's say all the power went out in your house, and you can literally use your truck as a giant battery bank and as a generator. So I think there's a lot of stuff that a lot of us don't think about doing. All right, next, let's move on to the usefulness of a bicycle. Energy, again, guys, using the body. You can literally, as we said about an alternator, you can take an alternator out of a car, hook it up to a bicycle, lift that bicycle up like those little exercise equipment that you have where the back wheel just keeps spinning. Well, you can literally take that rubber tire take it to where the pulley goes on your alternator, because it has like this little pulley rope, right? That's something to churn it. You can literally ride your bicycle and charge batteries if you wanted to. And look at the distance, how fast that, with no energy, how fast you can travel in contrast to walking. Let's say you need to go check on your neighbors or something. There was some catastrophe or something, you know, happened. You can literally get on your bike and go over places where vehicles can't. And you can go check on stuff relatively fast. You can get yourself a little cart and you could actually move things back and forth. So I think bicycles are definitely something to keep as a resource for energy, because they don't need any. All right, here's an interesting one too. It's a biodigester. And this is one that I have not fully educated myself on, but I'm educated enough to know the principles, you know, the ROI, how does it work, would I want to get one of these? And I think definitely, yeah, it would just be an addition, I think, to stuff. It's not one of the like main things that I'd want in my life. But basically what a biodigester is take all the food scraps that you're eating and you're going to throw them inside of this, basically this large like bag thing or a container with a lid on it that's airtight. And what happens is as the food rots, it causes a gas, and it's biodigesting. And where does that gas go? It starts to pressurize inside this bag or this container. And now done right, that pressurization that's happening in here can actually flow through some tubes. And you guys are probably hearing by now how dangerous this could be. But you can literally fill up tanks and you can store the stuff to do what? Light your house, cook meals, heat yourself. I actually don't have it on my notes, but now that we're talking about this, I heard of cow, like dairy farms running all 100% of all of their energy off cow dung. They take the cow dung and same thing. They put it inside of a tank. They let it rot. They capture all that gas, the methane and everything that goes off. They use that to power a generator, that which in turn uses for the lights to stay on and for also the milk machines and everything. 100% powered off the poop of the cows. So very, very interesting stuff if we start to look at these things. If we had enough food scraps and stuff like that, I think even in each individual, you know, a family, could probably produce some of their own energy just by the food scraps that they eat alone. Mulch piles is another energy thing I think that people don't realize. Have you ever seen somebody dump off some wood chips or something, or you ever turn your compost pile and see it just steaming? And it's super, super hot. Did you ever stick your arm inside of one of these things? There is a massive amount of heat. Sometimes I hear if there's too much dry material, these things could actually catch on fire. That's how hot it gets. Well, one of the things that you can do is you can take yourself, and you guys can run with this any way you want, but I'll make it simplified. You can get yourself, imagine you got a garden hose, right? And you stick this garden hose and you coil it. You'd probably need a good 300-400 feet of garden hose, hook them all together, and you would coil these things in a giant coil, like standing up, basically like a Tesla coil. And what you do is you would just take yourself a bunch of raw material and you would throw it and just bury the hoses and bury as much of it as you can. And what's going to happen is turn the water on in a trickle down the other end, just enough to get yourself wet, say to take a shower. What's going to happen is as that thing's biodigesting and all the heat is forming like an oven, it's going to heat that water for free. Now you can urinate on these things, and the nitrogen, I guess, is what happens, or the ammonia from your human urine will actually ignite this thing, the chemical reaction will actually make it even hotter. So if you had people, and I know it sounds disgusting, but in a pinch, every time someone would urinate, have them urinate on the compost pile and watch that thing spark up and just heat up even more. So there's many, many applications. You can run that hose without any water, put it inside your house, put a fan on the other end, and watch hot air blow out the other end. You guys see where this is going? You can do all kinds of things. God, this list can go on forever. Algae ponds. Actually, I was just researching this morning. I don't know how or why, but it popped up. And basically algae, and I believe duckweed as well. If you took yourself a pond and you let duckweed grow on top of this, or you let algae grow, that's that green stuff, it looks like green wool. If you took yourself a water bottle, cut off the bottom, leave the cap on, and drill yourself a tiny little pinhole on top. Stick that bottle over the algae, let it sit there for a little while, maybe a couple days, I don't know if you can do it instantaneous, and then go and light the end. Now this is, you know, could be dangerous, it's going to blow, you know, some heat. There's some trapped gas in that little airtight container. And from what I read this morning very briefly was that it's about 10 times, I think, or 4 times more cost effective to, it's more cost of energy and stuff to produce algae fuels. And believe it or not, this is a actually real thing. And it burns clean. And all it needs is photosynthesis. But it takes about four times more money to make the fuels. But in contrast, to contrast to doing like say fossil fuels, but it puts out anywhere from 10 to 100 times more product than oil through the same amount of money and the effort. So it's a huge, huge thing. I think the gas industries, watch me get shot in the head from a Black Ops helicopter right now. The oil companies don't want you to know these things, but people are already implementing it in places where you can't grow food, maybe where things were horrible conditions. You know, you can't, the soil's all screwed up, or maybe it's just all rock or something like that. You can literally start growing algae in huge, giant vats, and you can start harvesting this stuff into biofuels, which you can use, apparently, I guess, to power, say, vehicles. And it burns a lot cleaner. So it's got, I mean, really huge. I even heard of people maybe being able to bloom algae into food. So very, very interesting and wonderful stuff. I've gone on really, really long here. I'm going to have to short this one out. But guys, I want to know if you guys want me to keep going. Let me know if you guys want me to, if you want me to keep going on Tesla coils, if you want me to go on geothermal, if you guys want me to go on to wafatis and root cellars, tankless water heaters, warm and dry clothes that keep yourself in cool clothes, which I do on the roof. When I work it on the roof, it gets so hot, I literally cover myself up like an Arab, and you feel my skin, it's ice cold. It's like an air conditioning system. I don't even have it on here, but I also have where you can run water down a towel, down a system where the, like a swamp cooler. It's the system the way a swamp cooler works. If you got yourself, say, a giant towel, and you just kept running, circulating water, keep that thing wet and put a towel behind it, well, as it's blowing air, it's literally going to cool things down. The other one I don't even have on here too is a clay pot. You can get a large clay pot, and then put about an inch of sand on the bottom of it, and you're going to want to make sure it's waterproof, there's no hole. And then you're going to lay a smaller clay pot in the center, and you're going to fill sand up around there, and you're just going to, till it reaches the top, basically sandwiches a layer between the two, keep pouring water in there and stick some milk in there. You can literally keep milk in between two clay pots for free, right? Free energy, just keep it wet. So guys, let me know if I brought you any value with that kind of stuff, and if you want me to go, because my list just keeps going on here. I guess I can probably make this into an hour and a half podcast or show. So yeah. All right, guys, that's the show. I want to thank you guys, each and every one of you, for taking the time out and being here today. And if you guys can, give me a thumbs up, a thumbs down. If you did give me a thumbs down, please let me know why. I love to hear all your guys' opinions, but it really helps me out. That's all I'm asking, is if you guys like and share, comment on the show, it helps the algorithms for this show to get known. That's what's going to keep the lights on around here. So guys, there's an email down below in the description. If you guys want to make any comments, just say hello, give any suggestions. And as I always say, guys, go out there and have yourself a near life experience. Don't lose your muchness. Carry on the fire and human up, my friends.